Hey everybody, welcome in. My name is Ernest and I'm going to teach you how to cook. Today on the show, we're kind of really going something that has a lot of history in it. It's called a milk can dinner. And I'm going to explain to you what all that is, but it's full of all kinds of meat and wonderful vegetables and it's only 30 minutes to cook. In the extra helping, I'm taking something that people don't necessarily like sometimes, Brussels sprouts, and I'm cutting them up and making a wonderful salad that takes just moments to throw together. It's a wonderful dinner tonight. There's a lot of root vegetables. There's a lot of yumminess. So what are we waiting on? Let's get going. This is Eating in Bed. You know, it wasn't until the 1950s or early 60s that the dairy industry really revolutionized itself. Until that point, people would milk cows in containers that were usually 5 or 10 gallons each, and then take it to a storage container in a larger building. And the storage vat, or whatever you want to call it, was actually surrounded by cold water. The water would circulate, and then eventually they would put the milk in the milk cans that we're used to, that are about 3 feet high, and they hold about 25 gallons or so of milk, and they were distributed to whoever. In the mid-60s, the dairy industry revolutionized itself, much like it is today, where the cows were milked automatically. The milk was sent right from the cow to the storage container. It was pasteurized and then sent out to wherever it needed to go. Then by the late 60s or so, a lot of dairy farmers and other farmers realized they had a lot of milk cans sitting around. And people would make planters out of them or do other things. But one thing that people started doing was actually cooking in the milk can. Many farms had farm hands that lived on the property as opposed to living in their own residence. And many times the farmer's family and the farm hands would all eat together. And the milk can became a great source of cooking a lot of food for a lot of people in one shot. They would put rocks in the bottom of it to keep the food off the direct heat over a campfire. And then they would layer in root vegetables and hard vegetables, everything from carrots, potatoes, onions, parsnips, sweet potatoes, cabbage, sometimes zucchini squash and yellow squash, which would sometimes go soggy. And then they would top it off with meat. It could be sausage, bratwurst, chicken, steak, anything they had on the farm. And it fed a whole lot of people. It cooked in about an hour and everybody was fed. Well, that idea fast forwarded well into the 21st century. And I'm gonna take you into my kitchen and show you how to make a 21st century version of the milk can supper. We're gonna take a lot of the same elements and change up a few, and we're gonna have it ready in about 30 minutes once it gets on the heat. You're really going to enjoy this, I think. So let's get going, and we're gonna make a milk can supper right now. You know, as I noted earlier, milk can supper is really just a great way to get a lot of things into one pot and get everything cooked in 30 quick minutes. I mean, quick meals are just essential, and the vegetables are at their ready now that fall and winter is upon us. A lot of great root vegetables are going to be in season, so it's a perfect time to make soups and stews and one-pot meals, and this is what we're going to do today. But let me show you some of the vegetables we're actually using in this today. The first thing I have is 2 pounds of red potatoes. I'm trying to stick with potatoes that are a little smaller in circumference, so they're a little bit more even. Just give them a quick wash. You don't even have to cut these. However, if they're a little bigger, you can just cut them in half if you need to. I also have 1 head of cabbage, just a good cabbage. You don't need Savoy cabbage or anything like that. This is just regular good cabbage. I have 3 ears of corn right here. I just shucked it a little bit ago, got the silks out of it. We're gonna cut these up actually. Also, I have 1 pound of carrots, just washed the outside. We're going to slice these up in just a couple of minutes. I have 3 cloves of garlic over here that we're going to use. I'm just going to put these in whole, although you can smash them if you want a little bit more stronger garlic flavor if you want. I have 1 bell pepper and 1 large white onion. Now, the chopping on this is really easy. There's not a lot to do, and we're putting it all in our large Dutch oven, the enamel one that I showed you a while back on my regular vlog, if you watch that. It's a big 6-quart thing, and we're gonna have to get kind of inventive on how we put the stuff in this pot, but I guarantee you we'll get it all in there. The last thing I have is 2 pounds of Bratwurst. There's a lot of different kinds of sweet sausage, hot sausage. You could do different things like that, Italian sausage, but this Bratwurst really has a lot of great flavor to it. And that's what we're going to use for our recipe. This is about 2 pounds. The packages are usually just a tad over a pound, and I have 2 packages total worth here of Bratwurst. So that's what we're going to use today. So first of all, in our white pan here, this is a wonderful 6-quart Dutch oven. I'm just gonna add only about a tablespoon of olive oil. Don't want a whole lot to start. Just enough to cover the bottom of the pan. And we're gonna bring that to temperature, and we're going to brown the bratwurst. We're not gonna cook them all the way through. Bratwurst are pretty thick like any other sausages like this, and it would just take forever to cook all the way through. So we're just gonna get a nice browning on the outside, and we're actually gonna cut these in half and then put them back in last. But first, we're gonna bring our oil up to temperature. I just want to share with you real quick, I got this Dutch oven. I was kind of searching around. Lodge has really great ones. La Crusade does. They're a little bit more expensive. Staub does as well. They're a high-end brand. But then I happened to be at Target just about 2 to 3 weeks ago, and I thought, I'm going to look for them. They have cast iron as well, and they have their in-house brand called Threshold. Well, this 6-quart pot, which is white and the color that I wanted for this, started at $49.99. Not a bad price, only a few dollars difference from the Lodge pot of the same size. However, I happened to find it on sale for 15% off, and of course, if you use your Target Red card, your debit, or your credit card, you get another 5% off. So I came in under $40 for this wonderful pot, and they're really great. You got to be careful. You don't want to chip the edges or anything like that, because if you do, it can kind of rust. It'll expose the actual cast iron. However, if that happens, you can just take a little bit of vegetable oil, like a Crisco or something like that, that you would season your normal cast iron with, and just put it right over the chipped area, and that will kind of season the exposed cast iron, and you won't have any problems with it rusting over time. Be careful also how you drag it across the burners, how you wash it. Just kind of baby it a little bit, and these things will last you a very long time. I really love the lid on this as well. It's a flat lid. It's got a nice sealed edge, and it fits in there so nice and tight like that when you need to put the lid on something and let it steam underneath. You know your oil is up to temperature when you can kind of put your hand down in there and feel the heat, and it will start to ripple and almost start to smoke. You don't want to burn the oil, of course, but you're getting close. So we're going to go ahead and get started with these sausages, or the bratwurst, I should say. And I've got the heat on near high because this is going to bring down the temperature a minute. Just kind of snuggle all these up in there. You're going to add the sausages and brown them, if I can get them in the pot. It's going to be about 8 minutes total, and you're going to turn them once during that process. You can get them all down in here. Remember, we're just browning them a bit. We're not going to overdo it. We're trying to cook them all the way through. Okay, so we're going to go on this about 8 minutes. I'm going to turn them once, about 4 minutes into it, and pull them out, and we're going to continue on. Gosh, you can already smell them. They just smell wonderful. Okay, so I've turned over the bratwurst and they're cooking for another few minutes on the other side. Let me clear out some of my vegetables here, and I'm actually going to start cutting everything up. We'll go ahead and start with the carrots first. Now cut the tips off of these. Just be careful. Carrots are so pesky sometimes. Now we're going to cut these into about 2-inch sections. So each carrot's going to go about 2 cuts in it, if I can keep them on the counter. And now we're going to get to our cabbage. I've got this one big weird leaf here I'm going to get rid of. But you're really going to cut from the root side. Now our brats are almost done. You can't see them over here, but I'm going to actually turn heat off on these for a minute and pull them out and just set them to the side. And now let's get to the cabbage. We're going to cut it from the root end. I'm going to start right in the middle here. Be careful. Boy, cabbage is hard to cut. Just get in there after it. Just kind of work through. Just kind of baby it through. Cut it in half. And you're ultimately going to cut this into eighths. So we're going to take each half, cut it in half so we have fourths, and then cut each one of those so you have eighths overall. Now let's get the corn on the cob. We're gonna cut that into thirds. Boy, that is some good corn on the cob there. Doesn't wanna come apart. Now, I'm gonna hold on to the pepper until a little later. The pepper can really get mushy really fast. So we're gonna add this about halfway through. We're gonna steam this for 30 minutes. At the 15 minute point, we're gonna add the pepper on top and cook it for the last 15 minutes or so. But let's get the onion here. It's the last thing we really have to do. This really is one of the easiest prep works when it comes to cooking, because you don't have to do a whole lot of cutting. It's just really assembling bigger pieces of vegetables. I mean, I don't mind the knife work when I'm doing stuff, but if I can make it a little easier and do it in big chunks, even better. So we're gonna cut the onion in half and cut each half just into thirds. This guy kind of fell apart, but that's okay. We'll cut right there and right there. And we're also gonna use some salt, pepper, a little bit of thyme. Let's get all this in the pot. Just real quick, these brats have browned so nicely over here, and I'm just gonna cut them in half. You can see that they're still raw and pink right in the middle, and that is perfectly fine. Just cut them in half, and we're gonna put them in last. Just like that. Now you can see in the bottom of the pan that there is this great fond that build up, which is, they call it fond. It's kind of the residue of the sausages that cook. So now we're gonna start layering our vegetables in. You have to be pretty creative with this, but stick with me, this is gonna work. First of all, we're gonna start with our potatoes. My heat is on medium for right now. I'll put these potatoes right in the bottom. Like I said before, people used to put rocks in the bottom of the milk cans to kind of keep it off the heat. Really, you can just use the potatoes for that and you should be fine. All right, so layer them right in the bottom of the pan, just like that. Next up is the cabbage wedges. Now, remember, this cabbage is actually going to cook down a little bit as we go. So it may seem pretty bulky right now, but if you give it just a bit, you're gonna be okay with it after this is done. I do have the heat on underneath here, just to keep things rolling. I don't want to burn anything, actually, but. Next up, you're going to add the corn and the carrots. So this is one of those things where you really have to just kind of, wherever you've got an empty space, that's where you're going to put some corn. You might have to move the cabbage around a little bit. Poke it down in a hole. Whatever you can find, that's what you want to do. All right, carrots in next. Might have to be a little creative with that as well. Remember, this is all about cooking in one pot in one layer. So the only rule is maybe the certain way to layer it, but you can get it in there. Remember, this is a 6-quart pot. If you happen to have a 7-quart pot, well, that's probably even better. Okay, and then onion on top of that, which is pretty easy. Now I know what you're thinking already. You're thinking, Ernest, that lid is not gonna go on the pot. It will though. I'm gonna show you how. All right, just the garlic anywhere. I kind of spread that out a little bit. Oh, that looks so good already. Doesn't it? It just looks like a soup almost, like a deconstructed soup. All right, bay leaves down in there. Kind of put these right behind a piece of cabbage or something here. There we go. Okay. Now on top of that, I've got 1 tablespoon of salt right over the top. Make sure you're pretty even with it. Good bit of black pepper, probably about 1/2 teaspoon or so. Oh, forgot a carrot. And lastly, about 1 teaspoon or 2 of thyme. Now, if you have a fresh thyme, use about 10 sprigs. I'm using some dried thyme here, and I'm just gonna sprinkle the equivalent of about 1 teaspoon to 1.5 teaspoons all around here. Just has that nice earthy flavor to it. And on top, we're gonna put the sausages. I know you're still thinking, what about that lid? Don't worry, I got you on this. What you have to remember about this is that the cabbage is going to shrink down as it cooks. it's going to wilt, and so will the carrots a little bit and the onion, and that's going to get the lid back down on there. So it might steam a little bit to start with, or might be off, I'm sorry, on the top, but it will get down in there eventually. Now I'm going to turn my heat up on high, and I've actually got a cup and 3/4 of a good beer. Pour that right over the top. Make sure it doesn't run over the sides. You want it just like I did. You want it inside the pan. And that's going to steam everything. So keep it on high. You can't really see when it's boiling, of course, but you can start to see little like little vapors coming up through there. That's when you know. Put your lid on top, just like that. Now, you can see it's not fitting on here. It's sideways. But as that cabbage starts to wilt down, the lid will go down a little bit. So 15 minutes right there. And then in the meantime, I'm actually going to cut up this red pepper that I have. And at the 15 minute mark, I'm gonna lay the red pepper just right on top here. There will be room. Go for another 15 and then we're done. I'm gonna let this cook. Stay tuned, because after the break and the extra helping, I'm showing you how to make that Brussels sprout salad. If you don't like Brussels sprouts, just stay with me on this. If you can eat the cabbage in this meal, you'll love the Brussels sprout salad that I'm getting ready to make. It's got cheese and nuts and a nice vinaigrette dressing. Did I mention cheese and walnuts? Oh, can't go wrong with it. Stay tuned, I'll see you right after this. We're gonna eat this milk can supper. See you in a bit.
When you earn a break, there's a great new way to enjoy it. Take 5, light wafers, silky peanut cream in Hershey's milk chocolate. The richness of a candy bar without the heaviness. So it makes your break fulfilling without filling you full.
Hi, how'd everything go?
A little slow.
Take 5. You earned it.
There's no sense in rehashing. They have to improve the deal.
American had the first flight. You're set.
Perfect. What's the best they can offer?
Looks like 52 a share.
Not good enough.
Is this from Legal? Here are your tickets. You have boarding passes and seat assignments. It's American. Go straight to the gate. Good luck.
Luck? Luck is for rabbits. When you're something special, people know it.
First, you're going to start with 2 pounds of Brussels sprouts. You're going to start by cutting the bloom end off of the Brussels sprout. That's the part where it comes off of the stem. Then cut the Brussels sprout down the middle through the root end. And then cut through each half of the Brussels sprout. You're almost going for a shredded effect. Some chunks can be a little bit bigger than others. When you're done, wash it in a salad spinner and set it aside. In a bowl large enough to handle all the Brussels sprouts, add 1/4 cup of lemon juice, 1/3 cup of finely chopped green onions, 1 clove of garlic grated with a microplane, 1 tablespoon of Dijon mustard, and 1 tablespoon of coarse ground mustard, 1/2 teaspoon of salt, and 1/8 teaspoon of sugar. Add a little black pepper too if you want. Whisk that together just until everything's mixed. Then with a whisk, slowly mix in 6 tablespoons of olive oil. This creates an emulsion and it'll get nice and thick. When it's done, toss the dried Brussels sprouts back into it. Toss the greens so everything is covered with the dressing. At first it seemed like it won't go that far, but it will. Just keep working with it. Once it's all tossed together, leave it sitting on the counter uncovered for 30 minutes. After 30 minutes, add 1 cup of shredded pecorino cheese and 1/2 cup of walnuts, pecans, or pine nuts. Toss all of that together, add a little salt and pepper to taste, and you're ready to eat. You can change up the type of hard cheese that you put in here and change up the kind of nuts that you add as well. This makes a great snack on its own or a wonderful side dish for any dinner. The longer it sets, the better it gets. Also, try throwing in a few croutons. That's Brussels sprout salad. Enjoy. Okay, so it's been about 30, 35 minutes. Let's take a look at this pot. It's going to be so good, you guys. Let me turn the fire off. Set this to the side. Ooh, look at that. See, everything has shrunk down a little bit because of that cabbage shrinking down. And you can see that the peppers I put in the last few minutes, it's absolutely gorgeous looking. Now you can kind of just dump all this out if you wanted to, but I actually, I'm just gonna take some tongs here, and I have this, my tray, or not a tray, it's actually a baking dish, that I'm gonna put this out onto. Pull all the peppers and onions out together. Get them in there. You see that? And just line all this up. Put the sausages in here. And you know what? That thyme, that dried thyme that we put on there, smells so delicious. The sausages have nice browning on them, but then they've been steamed and cooked, so you know that they're not overcooked. They're still juicy. The flavor of the beer is in there. Oh, so good. Big, see, cabbages are just wonderful. They're not too soggy or anything like that. The ones in the bottom might be a little bit softer, but no big deal. Oh, the carrots too. Forgot about the carrots. Oh, and the corn. Look at that. The corn's just covered with salt and pepper and that thyme. Does it just look beautiful? Another big piece of cabbage. See, the root end comes right off there. You can actually just cut it off right there if you need to, and then just cut into the cabbage as you want while you eat it. Some more onion. You could really, if you have one of those big silver roasting trays, like you use for a turkey that you buy around the holidays or whatever, if you didn't have a roasting pan of your own, you can just kind of pour it out into that or separate it like we're doing here. And let your guests just pick at it. Give everybody a big fork and a knife, and they can just dig in and get what they want to right out of there. Oh, there's a bay leaf. You want to get rid of the bay leaf there. Just discard that. There's always this debate whether bay leaves add flavor or not, but I think they do. They're great aromatic. Oh, look at that potato. I bet it just falls apart. See, potatoes are done when you can just stick a knife in it. Goes right through there. That's good. More cabbage. I mean, what a wonderful spread of food. The corn is nice and tender. Oh, it just looks so delicious. The cabbage is nice. It's not too mushy or anything like that. There's peppers down in here. The potatoes are just wonderful. Like I said, let me get a knife here. Let me show you this again. The knife just goes right through those potatoes. Remember, they were on the bottom, so they were getting all of that juice from the sausages and everything else that finally hit the bottom. So they're gonna be the most flavorful, not that anything else isn't. Let's try this though. How can you not dig into that? I think what I wanna try though is actually just a little bit of carrot and a little bit of the sausage to start. Believe me, when this camera shuts off, I'm gonna be trying everything. There's a piece of potato over here I'm gonna try as well. But this is just, That's so good. Instead of it just being steamed, where a lot of times you can lose a lot of flavor and it gets a little bland, this has some nice flavor underneath because of the thyme, the salt and the pepper, and the flavor of the beer. Those bratwurst are amazing. And that is what we call a modern milk can dinner. I hope you enjoyed it. I'm gonna go enjoy this right now with my roommate. If you liked any part of this video, give it a thumbs up. Leave a comment below if you've ever done layered cooking like this or a milk can supper. Let me know. Maybe if you traded something out, I'd love to hear that. Share it with a friend, and I will see you next time. I appreciate you watching. This is Eating in Bed. I'm Ernest, and I'm gonna go eat. Thanks for watching. Bye.